Hello, everybody. This is Ming Chen.
Hi, I'm Mike Zapsik from AMC's Comic Book Man.
And you're watching AFK, the AFK show, our favorite show on the planet.
One of.
So you're watching the right show. Keep watching. And keep watching.
Don't stop.
Put your hands together, Mr. Peter Mayhew. Keep it going, you guys. I'm sorry?
That was the shortest Q&A I've ever done. Bye-bye. How are you getting on?
Peter, it's good to see you again, my friend.
Wonderful to be here.
We had you on Fox 26 last year, and it's always a treat to see you. And I understand you've kind of been a busy guy lately.
Kind of, yes.
Okay, I'm just going to cut to the chase. So what happens in The Force Awakens? No, I'm kidding.
You're going to have to wait till Christmas.
Which we're so excited about.
Yeah.
You know, but I have to start with the top question. I didn't realize this. Did you know that Chewbacca is a Texan?
Of course he's a Texan. That was the reason I got married to a Texan over here, so I could become a Texan.
Yeah, no, I know. By that accent, it sounds like you're from Tomball. It's a joke. But you live in Texas now.
Yep.
And so why it. Texas? I love that.
Well, think about it. Most of the stuff that we do is here in the States. Texas is central to everywhere in the States. New York is 4 hours. L.A. is about the same. You go up to Canada. Across the border to Canada. It's about the same flight. You come down to Mexico, it's the same time. So Dallas is home to us now.
I love it.
It's wonderful.
I think it's fantastic. Hey, how about that? He lives in Texas, you guys. All right, now, you and I spoke on television about a year ago when you were here with us at Fox, but you know, TV's so quick, you get 20 seconds, you don't really get a lot, maybe 2 minutes, don't get a lot of time to talk. So today we're actually going to catch up and find out some stuff. I've always wanted to ask, how did this whole thing start for you? How did Chewbacca start?
Chewbacca started as a newspaper article. I was working in a hospital as an orderly, and the newspaper guy from a local newspaper, came along and saw how tall I was and how big my feet were. And they were looking for people with big feet for the Guinness Book of Records. So he does an article. That article goes into a national press, and a week later, I get a call from not Fox, but I think it was Columbia, to do a showing or to do a part in Sinbad and the Eye of the Tiger, the Ray Harryhausen film. I played the Minotaur. So that was a little character, but you know, and that we did that, was pretty successful. And on the way back, someone said, "Would you like to do some more?" Well, I'd almost had a holiday for about 6 weeks. We were out in Malta, in the sunshine, brilliant, beautiful, almost Texas weather, but not quite. And I get a phone call. "Would you be interested in a character in a sci-fi movie?" Yeah, why not? You know, you don't get these chances very often, and you do it. He said, "Yeah, come up, see George, and we'll sort the costumes out." So I go up to the studios, and I'm sitting in George's office, which is probably about the size of this room. That's how the other half live. And along one wall, there's all the major characters. You've got 3PO, R2, all the major characters. One end, you've got Vader. Where is he? Oh, is he gone?
He might be in the hallway. I know he's heckling people in the hallway.
Okay.
I didn't realize Vader was such a heckler, by the way.
He's all right. So I looked at it, 6'9", too small. Yeah. Looked along the other edge, the other way, and there's this walking carpet. A shaggy dog, almost like a Neanderthal man. So, and it had 8 foot plus with a question mark. Can you, you know, and blue eyes. I sit down on a sofa. Door opens, George walks in with Gary Kurtz, who is the associate producer. And I stand up. George is tiny. And he looks at me and went, "Hey, Gary, I think you found him." That was it. 20 minutes. That was the creation of that particular character. Next day, we're up at the costumiers, getting the costume made. Face mask done the week after that. And within 3 weeks, we were shooting on the docking bay 94 under that big, big ship. And it was a big ship. You know, it was about 15, 20 feet high, 40 feet wide. It really was big, big. And the rest is history, you know. And we just, nobody realized how successful it was going to be. All right, you knew that with the stars that you had, Alec Guinness, Peter Cushing, blah, 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 they're all there. It should have been a success instantly. Not really, because they released it into the States and the critics criticized it. It comes over to England and Europe. They hadn't seen anything like it. All the stuff that was on the screen was sex and violence. You know, beating people up, blah, 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 you name it. This was something that you could take any children, adults, grandparents to go and see and still enjoy it through, you know, because there was no blood, no fighting, no nothing. So it was a question of, yes, this is going to succeed. And by God, it did. It came back over here and was totally successful. And when, about, 6 months later, we get a call from the same company about Empire coming back. Oh, we're going to do Empire, which is the second section in the trilogy. Would you be interested? I said, Amy, my boy, get me a script and I'll do it. So that was it, because it made it a lot easier because we knew each other's actions. Therefore, you know, it was everybody knew what they had to do and what their characters were. And by this time, the fans were coming out in their droves just to see it. And as I say, you're there and you do, you're doing stuff and you've got a good idea of what is actually going to happen. You get more of a story the further the filming goes. Jedi was the third one, or the last one that we thought was going to be around. But 15 years later, we get a phone call. Oh, we're doing episode 1, 2, and 3. We don't need you for 1 or 2, but we'd like a cameo from you for episode 3. Oh yeah, right, okay, fine. Beats working for a living. So we go out, we do episode 3, which the highlight was when we help Yoda escape from the pod. And blue screen is wonderful because there was a dustbin and a bag of sand, which was the escape pod and the Yoda. So as we're running away, I pick up Yoda, swing him on my shoulders, CGI takes over, goes into the pod, gone. So that was, you know, but they didn't even tell me what they were doing. So how the hell do you react to a blue screen? It's hard, because all the council were axle stands and light stands. So you had a light stand over there with a tennis ball with a smiley face on it, and that was Sam Jackson as one of the ministers or the controllers. So yeah, and as I say, there's a lot gone on between that, and we get. You know, we do conventions and stuff. Then, sort of 18 months ago, we get a phone call. Another one. Here it goes again. Would you be interested?
Yeah. Don't change your number, by the way, because I have a feeling there's going to be a few more calls. Just a tip.
Okay. So, you know, I said, well, you know, we've got a new director, and we're doing things in different styles. We're going back to not quite old-fashioned, but it's pretty close. So it will be wonderful, and everybody will enjoy it. So Anybody got any questions?
Yeah, I've got one more and then we can jump to questions, but I wanted to ask you, I mean, what does it feel like for you personally to be a part of history?
It's always been part of history, ever since the first one, ever since that, we saw the trailer for Star Wars in London, in its theatre, with Dolby Sound. And that first remark, that first scene where the Admiral's ship comes across and then a TIE fighter comes underneath, and you wonder where the hell it's going, and it disappears into the hold of the Admiral's barge. So I knew that was going to be it was going to work in our favor, and people would want to see it. And then it's gradually come up. It's been there, and it's done its job. It's created a completely universal sci-fi existence. Everybody sees it. Everybody appreciates it. It doesn't matter whether you're a Star Trek fan or a Star Wars fan. You're talking about the same. You're talking about the same scenes and same theories of what you expect from a sci-fi. Everybody's into sci-fi, and the beauty of my character is that it's a teddy bear. Look at him. He's got more hair than I can't think. He's got more hair than most people have. People carry little chewies in their vests, right, and things. I've seen bikers with leather jackets and leather vests, tiny little chewies from Lego. I don't know. Sometimes you think, am I doing this right? Then you look around here and you know damn well that you've done it right.
Peter, I read an article, and I want to see if this is true, that you actually learned the movements for Chewie by visiting like a zoo, or there was some kind of an animal thing involved where you learned movements, you studied and watched.
That is political BS.
Okay. I think we reported that on ours. No, I'm kidding. But I guess, I don't know. So where did you learn the movements for Chewie? You know, how did you, because there's never been a character like it.
No, remember when George gave me the instructions, he said, Chewie is a mime character. Therefore, he has to watch and learn and listen to whatever anybody else is saying. You get four people in a Falcon cockpit. You've got Han, you've got Leia, probably Luke, and maybe Alec. You've got to watch all those things and all those amounts of movement of what they are actually talking about. And you get a reaction off that. That's the only way that you can do it. So my homework was to look at the script, work out what was going to be there, and remember the words that they came out with, so that you could click off and click on to what they were actually doing.
Okay.
It works.
Interesting. I know you guys have a lot of questions, and by the way, I warned them, Peter. I said, don't embarrass us in Houston. Don't come on, you guys. Good questions. This is what I want. So I warned them.
Good.
Really? Okay, you guys ready? And we'll do this since we're intimate here. We can just raise your hand and like back in school, you can stand up. Who wants to be first? Right here in the front. You can get us started, sir. Go ahead.
No.
No.
That's simple. No, because they basically use the same costume, same design of costume. It was slightly different in certain ways, but you will have to watch the new movie to see the differences. Oh, and I'm surprised that your parents let you go and see it at that particular time. Okay. Not a problem.
We'll take one in the back right there. Go ahead, sir.
One of the trailers, you're in a scene with Harrison Ford and he goes, "Chewie, we're home." Is that just another line
or
another scene, or is there anything special about that?
You're gonna have to wait and see.
Now, it's so funny because they warned me when I immediately said, "Dave, can you do Peter Mayhew's panel?" And I was like, "Oh yes, I'm so nervous. I'm so excited because I'm such a geek for this." They told me I wasn't allowed to ask those kind of questions. So
no.
I'm glad you snuck that one in.
All right.
Go ahead. We'll take this guy right here, the Wolverine shirt. Go ahead.
What Star Wars movie is your personal favorite and why?
Empire Strikes Back. The reason is because everybody knew what they were doing. We even got Carrie thinking about what she was doing, and you know how Carrie's brain doesn't work on certain things, but she was quite knowledgeable. You know, she even tried to help me mend the ship in one scene. So, but no, Empire was great because everybody was together. Right, everybody pulled together, and it was the only one that was really cold because we were up in Norway, and it was the only one that I had a decent suit for. You know, yak hair and mohair were wonders. So yeah, it was, as I say, it was Empire. My least favorite was Jedi. Those little monkeys. Getting everywhere. You know. Especially if you're up in the redwoods like we were and you're trying to swing from 80 foot trees that have been there for 200 years. And it just don't work. You know. Even I can't climb them, and I've got long legs. So, but no, each one has been an individual effort by a lot of people. The new ones will be even better. You know.
Great question, by the way. We'll go all the way to the back right there. I see a young man with his hand up. Go ahead. Oh, by the way, before we ask this question, isn't this great how the demographics span all ages?
Yeah.
I mean, people just love Star Wars.
Yeah.
It's just, I love this. This is so great. Go ahead. Was it fun making The Force Awakens?
Yes. I wondered what he was talking about. We wrote it under a different title, so. It was great fun. And everybody, as I say, they were using a lot of stuff that hadn't seen the light of day for about 20, 30 years. So it was having new people with old equipment, and it works. This, you know, they got some brilliant footage, and you will see it on December.
Yes, we will. How many people, by the way, are going to go see the new Star Wars movie? Yeah, just
right, good. My profit goes up.
And then your phone will ring again, and we know that story.
And then Daddy will say, hey, Peter, we need you. We want you.
Let's go over here, right here, yeah. The blue, right here. Yes, sir, go ahead.
Yes, sir.
His favorite to work with in all the movies, and he said, no fair picking Harrison Ford. Good question.
Actually, Alec Guinness. Alec Guinness was a wonderful master because you'd start in the morning and there'd be a green room. You go in the green room, there was always coffee and sugar, coffee and tea. And he'd come in fully dressed as Obi-Wan. He would come down, he'd sit down, he'd take a paper out of his pocket or out of his briefcase. He would discuss things with you. It could be cricket, it could be politics, it could be anything. And he would always accept your argument or agreement with him. And that's offset. But once we got on set, he would have learned his lesson, and he would have gone there, and he would have been okay. A long speech, like when he gives Luke his dad's lightsaber. Right? He did that 3 times, and that's quite a long speech. He screwed it up the first time. He did it again and again, and they printed the middle one. Perfect. Absolute perfect. All the pauses were in the right place, the inflections were in the right place. Therefore, that man, I learned a hell of a lot. But I still, you say, don't mention Harris. He learned me more than Alec did, purely because you were working so closely together. And of course, Gary was always fun. Mark, not so much, but Gary was always fun. Yes.
What was it like, I want to ask this, what was it like to get everybody back together when you were filming the new one? And was it like a high school reunion? Like, hey, it's the whole crew, the gang's all back together. What was that first day like for you?
Quite nostalgic, because you have two or three people doing one set, and then you move across to another set, and we'd be another set of people. Harrison and all the new boys on the block, and who wanted to be part of that tradition because they knew what we had established at that particular time. So we told them and showed them, and they picked it up. They were good. They were a good set of kids.
That's magic right there. That's so awesome. Okay, let's get somebody from the middle right here. Go ahead.
What is the strangest piece of merchandise he's ever seen of Chewbacca on?
Probably a drinking mug. It's like a beer stein, only made in pottery, and it's the whole thing of pottery. And try and sign one of those with a pen. You turn it upside down and go like that. And as I say, you're there, you do it. And we've had all sorts, you name it. Heads, gloves, you name it. I mean, it's been a real eye-opener because people bring up T-shirts and stuff like this that you don't like not to say, I can't sign that. But sometimes you wish you could, especially if you've got a Sharpie that is real nice and tight on the end, and then you go like that on a T-shirt, and it screws the whole thing up.
Oh, you mean one of these?
Yeah. No.
Yeah, because Chewy was on everything for a while. Still yeah. is. You can find so many Chewy things and different poses.
Go on eBay.
Yeah, there's Chewies everywhere. All right, let's get somebody from over here. I know we haven't gone over here yet. Anybody over here have a question? Yeah, right over there. Go ahead, sir. Was there any time that he ever disagreed with the director?
No. The reason is simple. He paid the bills.
By the way, you're one of the only actors that I've ever interviewed that said that. Like, I fight with everybody. No wonder you've been working for so long, Mr. Mayhew. That's the attitude to have. Great yeah. question.
Yeah. Why not? You know, he pays the bills. He knows what he wants. I want to keep a job. It's that simple.
I'm right there with you, man. Let's get somebody right here. Sir, yeah, go ahead.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir, right there. You can, the orange right there. Yeah, the style of filmmaking was so revolutionary back in the day that yeah. you're asking about the new one. Is it a chance to...
But now they're going back to the old ones.
Actually, they have.
Yeah. It's a well-known fact that they've come back to the originals.
Right.
The old style, what do you mean, you know, are you talking about?
He's talking about 3D models and things like that. Like now, right now, a lot is so computerized when your filmmaking has really gotten computerized.
Yeah, but how do you shoot a model that's a third of the size of the original size model to make it look good? You take, for example, in Jedi, when they blow the Admiral's barge up, that was 6 inches square. Therefore, and yet the building, the barge itself was something like 120 feet long, 50 feet wide, and 30 feet deep. So you're not going to blow all that lot up. You're going to use a tiny little model. Saves them money, makes cheaper movies, gives them more space. So I think there's going to be a crossover between the two things. So you know, not my problem. I only go there and work.
Okay, what is Harrison? No, I'm waiting for somebody to ask this. What is Harrison Ford like?
Good question.
I'm so excited.
He can't fly helicopters. Boom, boom. No, he's great. He really is. He learned me a lot of stuff. How to do things, what to do, and he's the only guy on that set that would argue with George. That is power.
That is power.
Oh, wow. He goes, "No, George, you wrote it this way. I'm gonna say it this way. It means the same thing. Let's go." Boom. And George goes, "Okay, Harrison. Okay, let's go."
Do you realize I'm going to tell that story like for the rest of the Comicpalooza the entire weekend? I'm going to steal that. That is so awesome. Hold on, I got to tweet it. All right, let's get some more questions over here. Right there in the back. Go ahead. Right, sir, in the red. Go ahead. Any more children's books?
Maybe. I am not certain how much I can get away with them. Because you only stay a child as long as people, you know, you gradually grow up. So it's like being in it's like going from junior school to high school. You've got to come to an end on it. We will probably do another one, and I know that I've got a full book out, not out, but I've written a whole unit of from start to finish. From start, which was the hospital orderly job, right up to coming back from a convention after Jedi. So there's now at least 15 years to go back, to go in that book, and that will be a printed book, a hardback, hopefully. But we're not certain when we're going to do it, if we have time. If we've got time, we'll do it. If not, it sits on the library. It'll sit on the library shelf. Wait till the next one comes along. Okay.
What about that chapter that you're going to write about that panel you did with Dave Morales? I'm kidding. Okay, here we go. Right here in the front row. Stop it. You think you know a guy? Sounds good to me.
And Karen could even do it better than I could. No, we were. You obviously, you're wearing a mask. Therefore, it's like that. You can't hear. So your noise has got to be very, very loud for the other people around you to hear. They put that in. And then they run it through a man called Ben Burt for the sound effects. And that sound effects is taken out, or mine is taken out, and the other ones go in. That's what you're hearing at the moment during filming.
We got time for one more question. Who's got a good one? Let's hear it. Sir, right there in the black. Go ahead. Any deleted scenes that he wishes would have made the final cut?
No, that I can talk about.
Uh-oh. What? Wait a minute. Yeah, I want to see that movie. Do I? No.
No. You obviously, people that do that, you know, people that are capable of screwing things up, you're only going to screw them up so much. Then they'll cut it and reshoot it and throw that one away. It's that simple, because time is money.
Exactly. Peter, on the air last year on Fox 26, you made the Chewbacca sound for us. Any chance we can hear that? That's it. All right, you guys, give it up one more time, Mr. Peter Mayhew.